Christmas Eve, in the year of our Lord, 1842, streets alive with a happy throng. In the heart of the great city, in a darkened alleyway, a dingy counting house. Through the shutters guarding the narrow windows, a flickering light. In this dismal, cobwebbed room, the miser, Ebenezer Scrooge. Old, ill-favored, ugly. A second figure we see, stooping over a desk. His clerk, Bob Cratchit. The hour is late, yet still they work, toiling over musty ledgers by the fitful light of guttering candles. Inside, desolation and despair. Outside in the streets, blanketed in driven snow, children's voices raised in praise of the festive season.
Did I not bid you to bid those children be gone?
I did, sir, but they wouldn't take no notice.
No notice, eh? I'll soon shift them. Where's that ruler? Be gone, you little ruffian. Stop making that awful noise. Be gone, I say. Be off, I tell you. Get away from my door, or I'll fray the hides off you with this ruler.
A Merry Christmas. Humbug. Humbug. Who's that at this hour?
Good day to you, Bob.
Good day to you, sir.
Who calls at this late hour?
It's Mr. Fred, sir.
A Merry Christmas, Uncle, and God save you.
Humbug.
Christmas a humbug, Uncle. Fie, you don't mean that, I warrant.
I do mean it. Merry Christmas. What right have you to be merry? What reason have you to be merry? You're poor enough.
For that matter, Uncle, what right have you to be dismal and morose? You're rich enough.
Eh? Humbug.
Nay, don't be ill-tempered, Uncle.
What else can I be when I live in a world such as this, peopled by fools? Merry Christmas. Out upon a Merry Christmas. What is Christmas to you? But a time for paying your bills without money, a time for finding yourself a year older but not an hour richer, a time for balancing your books and finding every item in them for a round dozen a month presented dead against you. If I could have my will, every idiot who goes about with a Merry Christmas on his lips should be boiled with his own pudding and buried with a stake of holly through his heart, so he should.
Uncle!
Nephew, keep Christmas in your own way and let me keep it in mine.
Keep it? But you don't keep it, Uncle.
Let me leave it alone, then. Much good may it do you. Much good it has ever done you.
Ah, there are many things from which I might have derived good, from which I have not profited, I dare say. Christmas among the rest. I have always thought of Christmas time, as it has come its yearly round, apart from the veneration which is due to its sacred name and origin, if anything belonging to it can be apart from that, as a good time, a kind, forgiving, charitable, pleasant time.
Good time.
Therefore, Uncle, though it has never put a scrap of gold or silver in my pocket, I believe it has done me good and will do me good, and I say, God bless it.
Mr. Fred, bravo!
Let me hear another sound from you, Bob Cratchit, and you'll keep your Christmas by losing your situation. As for you, Mr. Fred, you're quite a powerful speaker. I wonder you don't enter Parliament.
Don't be angry, Uncle. Come and dine with us tomorrow.
See you damn first. Good day.
I'm sorry to find you so resolute. We've never had a quarrel to which I have been a party. Never, Uncle. Oh, well, I've made the trial in homage to Christmas, and I'll keep my Christmas humour to the last. And Merry Christmas, Uncle.
Good day.
And a Happy New Year. Merry Christmas, Bob.
Merry Christmas to you, Mr. Fraser. Merry Christmas, sir.
There's another fellow. The clerk, Bob Cratchit. 15 shillings a week, and a wife and family. Talking about a Merry Christmas, and I'll retire. driver to a lunatic asylum.
Sir?
Well, we'll...
A gentleman to see you, sir. Good day to you, sir. Scrooge and Marley's, I believe.
Well, have I the pleasure of addressing Mr. Scrooge or Mr. Marley?
Mr. Marley has been dead these 7 years. He died 7 years ago this very night.
Ah, well, I have no doubt his liberality is well represented by his surviving partner.
Who are you, sir? I have no recollection that we are acquainted.
Probably not. Goodman is my name, sir, of Goodman and Company, T.M. Porter's, Mincing Lane. Here are my credentials, sir.
What's this? Oh, Charity, take him away. I don't want to see him.
But at this festive season of the year, Mr. Scrooge, it is more than usually desirable that we should make some slight provision for the poor and destitute who suffer greatly at the present time. Many thousands are in want of common necessities. Hundreds of thousands are in want of common comfort, sir.
Are there no prisons?
Plenty of prisons, sir, unfortunately.
And the union workhouses, are they still in operation?
They are. Still, I wish I could say they were not.
The treadmill and the poor law are in full vigor, then.
Alas, both very busy, sir.
I was afraid from your first remarks that something had occurred to stop them in their useful course. I am indeed glad to hear news to the contrary.
My colleagues and myself, under the impression that these state institutions scarcely furnish Christian cheer of mind or body to the multitude, are endeavoring to raise a fund to purchase the poor meat and drink and means of warmth. We chose this season of the year because it is a time above all others when want is keenly felt and abundance rejoices. And now, sir, for what amount shall I inscribe your name?
Nothing.
Oh, you wish to remain anonymous?
I wish to be left alone. Since you ask me what I wish, sir, that is my answer.
But, sir,
I don't make merry myself at Christmas, and I can't afford to make idle people merry. I help to support the institutions I have named. They cost enough, and those who are badly off must go there.
Many cannot go there. Many would rather die than go there.
If they would rather die, then they'd better do so and decrease the surplus population. It's not my concern. It's enough for a man to understand his own business and not to interfere with other people. Mine occupies me constantly. I'll bid you good day.
But, Mr. Scrooge, surely...
I'll bid you good day. Show this gentleman out, Cratchit.
I beg of you, Mr. Scrooge, just...
Good day.
Good day, sir.
Dawdling as usual, Cratchit. Carols. Shh, shut that door. Come here, Cratchit. You'll want all day off tomorrow, I suppose.
If it's quite convenient, sir.
It's not convenient.
Oh, sir.
There's work to be done. Come in at 9 a.m.
Yes, sir.
For a couple of hours.
Oh, yes, sir. I will,
see you're not late.
I'll not be late, sir. And thank you, sir.
Before you go, put my gruel on the hob.
Yes, sir.
And my slippers to warm.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to the chop house across the street for my dinner. They take all the newspapers there. Lock up when you leave. I'll be back later.
Yes, sir. A Merry Christmas.
Bah!
Almost midnight, and Ebenezer Scrooge alone in the dismal, shadowed room. On his desk, open ledgers, debit and credit, and the hour strikes.
Marley is dead. No doubt of that. The register of his burial was signed by the clergyman, the clerk, the undertaker, and the chief mourner. I, Scrooge, signed it. And Scrooge's name is good on the stock exchange for anything he cares to put his hand to. But 'tis very strange. Marley's dead. What's that? What's that?
Ebenezer Scrooge.
What do you want with me?
Much. Much.
Who are you?
Ask me who I was.
Who were you then? You're particular for a ghost.
In life I was your partner, Jacob Marley.
Jacob Marley?
Oh, woe is me. Oh.
You're fettered. Tell me why.
I wear the chain I forged in life. I made it link by link and yard by yard. Yours was as full and as heavy and as long as this. 7 Christmas Eves ago.
Jacob, old Jacob Marley, tell me more.
Why it is I appear before you in this form you see, I may not tell. Yet I have sat invisible beside you many and many a day.
What?
That is no light part of my penance. Hark, you will be haunted by a threefold spirit.
A threefold spirit? I think I'd rather
not. Without these visitations, you cannot hope to shun the path I tread. Expect the first this night when the bell tolls one.
Couldn't I take them all at once and have it over, Jacob?
On the night which follows, expect the second at the same hour, and the third upon the third night, when the last stroke of 12 has ceased to vibrate. Look to see me no more, and look that for your own sake you remember what has passed between us.
Yes, but Jacob, I say, Jacob Marley! Why, he's gone. The clock of the old church. The hour, and nothing else.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
Eh?
Look upon me.
Are you the spirit whose coming was foretold to me?
I am that threefold spirit.
Your appearance is strange to me, spirit. I see a blaze of light about your head. And in your hand you hold a branch of holly. Who and what are you?
I am the ghost of Christmas past.
God rest you, merry gentlemen, there's nothing to dismay.
The ghost of Christmas past? The ghost of Christmas past? Long past?
No, your past.
My past. Spirit.
Well, mortal.
That light about your head is dazzling to me eyes. Can you not dim its radiance?
What would you so soon put out with worldly hands the light I give?
'Tis dazzling to me eyes.
You and your like have striven to extinguish it over the years without success.
I have? They're none known to me. What business brings you here, pray?
Your welfare.
My welfare? I am much obliged, but I would have thought that a night of unbroken rest would have been more conducive to that end.
Your reclamation, then. Huh? Take heed. Rise and come with me.
I am but mortal. Where would you lead me?
Through the air, above the crust of earth. Scrooge, what do you see?
I see a drawing room decked with holly. A young man and a beautiful, tender girl.
Look again and recognize.
Why, 'tis Emma, the girl I was betrothed to, and the man? Yes, it must be. It is my former self. Myself as a young man.
Listen, listen.
It matters little. To you, very little. Another idol has displaced me, and if it can cheer and comfort you in time to come, as I would have tried to do, I have no just cause to grieve.
What idol has displaced you?
A golden one.
I am not changed towards you, am I?
Our contract is an old one. It was made when we were both poor, and content to be so, until in good season we could improve our worldly fortune by patient industry. You are changed. When our contract was made, you were another man.
I was a boy.
Your own feeling tells you you were not what you are. I am. That which promised happiness when we were one in heart is fraught with misery now we are two. How often and how keenly I have thought of this, I will not say. It is enough that I have thought of it and can release you.
Have I ever sought release?
In words, no, never.
In what then?
In a changed nature, in an altered spirit, in another atmosphere of life, another hope as its great end, in everything that made my love of any worth or value in your sight. If this had never been between us, tell me, would you seek me out and try to win me now?
You think not?
I would gladly think otherwise if I could, heaven knows. If you were free today, can I believe that you would choose a dowerless girl? You, who in your confidence with her, weighed everything by gain?
No.
Or, choosing her, do I not know that your repentance and regret would surely follow? I do, and release you. With a full heart for the love of him you once were.
But Emma...
May you be happy in the life you have chosen.
Spirit, show me no more. Why do you delight to torture me?
One shadow more.
No more. No more. Show me no more.
As you wish.
You are to return, spirit?
Tomorrow night, upon the stroke of 12, think well upon what I have shown you.
For the second visitation.
Ebenezer Scrooge.
Ah.
Look upon me, Ebenezer Scrooge, look.
I see your spirit as I did last night. But there is a difference.
What change do you perceive?
You wear a holly wreath upon your head, and in your hand you hold a flaming torch.
You have never seen the like of me before?
Never.
Have you never walked forth with the younger members of my family? Meaning, for I am very young, my elder sisters born in these later years.
You bemuse me. I think not. Have you had many sisters, Spirit?
More than 1,800.
1,800?
One born each year of the Christian era.
A large family to provide for. And the cost in money.
Money? Money has no meaning for the members of my family, except for the happiness it provides. Our journey waits.
Spirit, conduct me where you will. I went forth last night on compulsion, and I learnt a lesson that moves me still. If you have aught to teach me this night, let me profit by it.
Touch my robe. We descend the Scrooge.
This house?
You know it?
Yes, yes. The home of my clerk, Bob Cratchit, isn't it?
It is.
Why do you wave your torch over the house?
I am the spirit of Christmas, Ebenezer Scrooge. I place my blessing on this dwelling.
But why? Bob Cratchit gets but 15 shillings a week.
Look through the window.
But I don't understand. 15 bob a week. Bob pockets each Saturday but 15 silver replicas of his Christian name. And yet you bless his house.
Watch. What do you see?
I see. Yes, there's Mrs. Cratchit, Bob's wife, laying the table for dinner. And there at the stove is young Peter. My, but he's grown since I saw him last. Tablecloth is threadbare, but spotless. The room bare, but spotless also.
This is a home, Scrooge.
And the shining light in young Peter's eye as he watches the stove.
The light of youth, unsullied and unspoiled. Listen.
Are the potatoes nearly done, Peter?
They smell done, Ma.
Give them one more turn. Careful now, they must be crisp and brown. Careful now, and no tasting.
Mother, what do you think?
No, let me tell. I want
children, to tell. Children, so one at a time, or both together. Well, what have you got to tell me?
We've just come from the bakehouse.
And we've smelled the goose.
The Christmas goose.
Children, don't make so much noise. You get me all flustered. Anyone would think it was the only goose in the world. Now, it must be getting late. And if you delay me, I shall never have the dinner ready for your father coming in.
Yes.
Dear, dear, whatever has got him and your brother Tiny Tim?
They'll be here soon, Ma.
I pray so. And Martha wasn't as late last Christmas by half an hour. Look out of the window and see if you can see her, girls.
Come on, we'll look and see if Martha.
Martha, come along the street, Martha.
Yes, here she is, Mother. Here's Martha, Ma. Martha, Martha. Here's Martha, Mother. Hurrah, hurrah.
Oh, look at the lovely goose.
Bless your heart alive, my dear.
Oh, it's good to be home.
Here, let me take your shawl and bonnet. My, my, how late you are.
There was a deal of work to finish up last night, Mother, and all the clearing away to do this morning.
Well, never mind, as long as you have come. Sit down by the fire and have a warm, my dear.
Thank you, Mother.
You must be worn out, my dear. Lord bless you.
Look, look, Spirit. Here comes Bob Cratchit down the street. And that's Tiny Tim on his shoulders. Waving his crutch and laughing. Tiny Tim's a cripple, Spirit.
Listen, listen all.
It's Father.
Yes, Father's coming now with Tiny Tim on his shoulder.
Don't dawdle, girls. Everything must be ready piping hot.
Let's have a game. Hide, Martha.
Let's hide, Martha. she hides under the table. Oh, yes. Stay as quiet as a mouse, Martha.
Poor father.
Crossed the sea, little Timothy on his own horse. Hey, well, here we are. Back safe and sound and all forgotten.
Gee up, hooray!
Down you get, Tim. That's the end of the ride. My, what solemn faces you girls all have.
Why, Bob, I thought you were never coming. Now, who's going to fetch that goose from the bakehouse?
I am.
No, me.
I'll fetch it.
Can I come too?
Yes, come on, Tim. Come on, Tom, Belinda. Hurry, before someone else has swallowed up our lovely goose. You know, they might swallow the ground quickly.
Where's our Martha?
She's not coming.
Not coming? Not coming on Christmas Day?
Well, you see.
And what was that, pray? A noise from underneath the table?
Well, Bob...
And what do my eyes behold? The tablecloth rising up towards me and...
Here I am, Father.
Martha, you little vixen. So you'd tease your poor old father, would you?
She meant no harm, Bob.
That I know. Give us a kiss, Martha, my dear.
Dear Father, I couldn't bear to see you disappointed. Sit you down, and I'll have Mother to dish up.
My man is blessed who can count his blessings such as I.
And how did little Tim behave in church, Bob?
As good as gold, and better. Somehow he gets thoughtful sitting by himself so much and thinks the strangest things you've ever heard. Do you know what?
What, Bob?
He told me coming home that he hoped the people saw him in the church, a cripple as he was, that it might be pleasant for them to remember on Christmas Day who made the lame beggars walk and blind men see.
Our poor little Tim, the weakest lamb of all our flock. Oh, Bob, do you think he ever will get well?
Of course he will, Mother. Why, he's stronger and heartier now than he ever was.
Pray God. Look to the stove, Martha. Here come the children. Open the door for them, Bob.
That I will, with a heart and a heart.
Here comes the goose!
Oh, my! What a goose! Now, sit down, everybody. You carve, Bob.
That I will, me dear.
See, the knife is sharp.
What a goose! I should say it was a goose. I declare that goose was never cooked in an oven. It must have been hatched like that.
Tim, you come sit by me. Quiet, children, please, quiet. Grace, Bob.
For what we are about to receive, may the Lord make us truly thankful.
Amen.
Amen.
And now...
Children.
And now, a Merry Christmas to us all, me dears. God bless us.
God bless us.
God bless us, everyone.
Amen to that.